Hi, my name is John Werner. I'm excited to share a few things with you. So I'm proud to be a TEDx curator. Many people that organize these TEDx events are incredibly talented. I give TED so much credit for putting out this opportunity, and it's a talent magnet for some of the most resourceful, visionary, can-do folks. And there's a legion of us around the world who organize these events. And often what's in common is that we want to pick great speakers and we want to put on a great event. And the audience is an afterthought. While we want a great audience, we're so consumed with the speakers and putting on an event that we're not able to focus it in an intentional way, in a timely way, ahead of time. And what I did in 2010, I put a few things in motion that had a profound impact on the outcome of my event, and I think it has applications to other TEDx's. And I think 3 years from now could be an exciting evolution of where TEDx goes. So what I did was I put out 20 pre-conference adventures. I had an event where 500 people signed up for it. I didn't charge anything. I filled up immediately. I waitlisted people. But the people that had the ticket to attend my event in June of 2010, I let them know about some opportunities. Go visit Google, get a behind-the-scenes tour of Google, climb a mountain with the top social media guy in the region. Can you, I feel like she's talking so loud. Other events like go meet the guys who built the first Segway and learn, you know, what went into it at the time. So I offered these 20 events, tour a jail and be with inmates, build a robot, go to a nuclear power plant. And so before the event even came together, my TEDx event, I crowdsourced all these people. So I had about a little over, close to 600 people that attended my event. But of these 20 pre-adventures, I had 500 people sign up for those. And of the 500 people, only half of them actually came to the event, to the TEDx event. The other half came because the ones that signed up and got into my event invited those people. So that's exciting that having pre-events can be a multiplier of your community. So in 2011, I decided to have events, adventures again. In 2010, I had 500 people sign up. In 2011, I had 20 pre-adventures and 25 post-adventures. And I had 5,000 people sign up for them. And when I was on stage of my event in 2011, I challenged the audience. I said, many of you could give TED Talks, but we have a finite number of slots, so not everyone is going to have that opportunity. But many of you could lead or facilitate an amazing adventure. And people rose to the occasion, and they curated their own adventures. And as these adventures would happen, people would write articles about it, or take pictures, or do video, and make mini documentaries. So suddenly I had content that I could edit that could go up on my website alongside the talks. Some of the interesting events were we got the screenwriter for the movie The Town and Gone Baby Gone, a Ben Affleck produced movie, give a walking tour of where the movie took place. And that crowdsourced all these people that wanted to start their own, become movie writers. That was really interesting. We had another one where the head of the FBI's polygraph testing came and talked about the polygraph and explained some of the strategies people try to use to beat the polygraph. Another one was we got behind the scenes tour of a sports team, the Patriots football team, which is one of the most valuable sports franchises in the world, the Red Sox. And what's interesting about this is in every city there's an MIT Media Lab type place or a sports team or an aquarium or things that are a competitive advantage to that region that would love to kind of reveal and give access to what they're doing. And those can be these kind of adventures and help your audience get to know each other before an after event or before the next event a year later. The other thing about this is you can have your speakers that gave a talk in years past do an adventure a few years later. So you can get an update on where that research went. Did it go anywhere? Did it fail miserably? Or did it lead to something much bigger? Or you have people who want to be speakers, but they don't fit in you know, your program, or maybe you want to test them out ahead of time and have them do an adventure to see if it works. The other thing is, as TEDx leaders, we're building this volunteer army, and often we want to give folks things to do that are important and meaningful and great leadership opportunities, and having folks do this is one way of doing that. So I think ideas worth spreading, that's central to what TED's about. By doing these pre and post adventures, and it actually doesn't need to be called an adventure, it could be called ideas in action. What it does is it disrupts the conference model. Instead of saying everyone has to be in an auditorium at the same space, the same time, it says throughout the year, let's get together around these things. And some people may show up because it's what they're passionate about, or it's what they know nothing about and they want to learn more about, or they want to bring people together, their children, their parents, someone they work with. And maybe people can't make it to our TEDx events, but an adventure may be scheduled at a time when someone who's either giving surgery or having surgery can make it. So I'm excited to do this. So at TEDx Boston, which I was one of five executive curators, we've had 5,500 people participate in these adventures over the past 2 years. What I decided, and this was, I lost some sleep over making this decision, was that I would start a new TEDx, and that the purpose of this TEDx was to reverse engineer all the tools and create the inspiration around, or create the model that could be an inspiration around these adventures. So in a few years, many TEDxes around the world might emulate this. So I'm building a team that's going to help come up with an amazing registration system that's open source that we can send around, an amazing system to document people's experiences, an amazing system to help select which of these TEDxes adventures should happen, and also best practices in leadership and ensure quality control. And TEDx Beacon Street is going to take place on November 18th of 2012. And a challenge that I put out at this conference that has been responded to very well is that I said to the first 100 curators from around the world, if they can fly their way to Boston, that I will put them up for 3 days. I will have someone on my team who's in charge of sourcing amazing, wonderful places to stay, kind of like what we're doing here in Doha, in Boston. And the folks that come will, one, get a menu of adventures to go on before the event on November 18th so they can experience it. Two, they'll get a training on what we're doing and get a toolkit. So if they want to app up to use some of this stuff at their TEDx, they can. And three, they'll be incorporated into the program somehow. And I haven't thought this through, but my guess is I'll get a bunch of interesting people, and having them on stage or having them facilitate things or just being around will be a win-win-win for everyone. And if we really want our ideas to get velocity and views, you know, TED is powerful because 750 million people as of March had viewed the 1,000 TED Talks. As we want to get the TEDx Talks viewed, having a diverse audience that can help spread those ideas and respecting our audience and having our audience be multipliers of who knows about us is going to be an important asset. I think our TEDx team should think about, what are the resources, what are the community assets in their area that they should be engaging? So they have this huge database that they do nothing with between their two events because they spend so much energy pulling off their event that they just want to go dark for the months after. But if we could have these adventures offered like quarterly, it would be a great way to engage the audience and get them, you know, to feel part of the event. But it also could be a great way to train curators not just to think about the red dot and who stands there, but who in the community. So if you want that one venue that you always dreamed about but is too expensive, do an adventure there, have a bunch of interesting, diverse people show up to it, have that great venue say, holy cow, you guys are awesome, and then that will lead to you getting that in-kinded donated to you. The other thing is that all this may sound like a lot of work and like how can it be done, I would argue the opposite. If you don't do this, you're making more work for yourself. That this allows you to have a more sustainable event and can help on all the fronts that keep us up at night, that make us worry, that make us stress, and make us pray that there isn't a wedding we have to go to the week before our TEDx event. And then one other TEDx adventure that's kind of cool is we had a guy on stage who played medieval and ancient Chinese musical instruments. And so a few months after he performed, and he was brilliant, we did a petting zoo of Chinese medieval and ancient instruments. We had 50 people show up and play this. And we approached WGBH, the top recording studio space in the area, and said, not, please, can you donate something? Say, hey, we have this great event. Would you like it to be at your space? And they opened it up to us, Fraser Auditorium. The other thing about this is that, so we had another guy, a billionaire, who was writing a book. Bob Metcalf was writing a book on Metcalf's Law. And I said to him, how's the book coming? And it sounded like he hadn't gotten much beyond the title. And I said, oh, why don't we help you and do an adventure? You can pick up the tab for the dinner. We could have it at your favorite restaurant, and we'll get some interesting people in the room to give you advice. We also did this with the founder of Boston Scientific. We got 100 people in the room for his event, and 7 or 10 for the other guy. And so this is an example where we're helping people. So these adventures shouldn't cost anything. It's the value proposition that we're saying to the people who are opening up their venue, the people who are giving the presentations, that because we can bring people together, that they would benefit from it. And then the talks doesn't have to be just one person. It could be a panel of people, you know, with juxtapositions. And the other thing is, we still need to be an event. We're licensed to do an event, and that TEDx Adventures are a way to engage your community between your annual events. Because I don't want this to seem like I'm going rogue and saying, you know, down with the system. This is still working within the system. So if you're worried that you're going to get a call from Laura saying cease and desist, no, this works. And over the next year, I'm going to come up with some models that people can use and plug and play. And my goal is in 3 to 5 years, 50% of TEDx's have some form of pre and post adventures. All right, that's some more stuff.
That's great. Okay. Oh, I got